So a quick introduction about myself. This is Praveen, the trainer for this session. I have around 18 years of experience into various Microsoft technologies, and I'm working on Azure. So I'm a Microsoft certified trainer, certified solutions architect, a developer. All right, let's start. I would like to share my screen now. Can someone confirm if you're able to see my screen? What is cloud computing? You guys know, anybody? Chaitanya, Uday, Chandrasekharan. I'm sure at least you know, you might have heard about cloud, right? Can you explain what is cloud? Your own terms. Cloud computing is nothing but delivery of compute services. That compute service could be anything, starting from a server, web server, database server. It could be even creating IP address, a network, anything. So creation of all these over internet, that's called as cloud computing. What is cloud? Why it is called as cloud? Because it's the servers or the infrastructure is located somewhere. It is far away from its customer. That's why it is called as cloud. So you can work with, you can interact with cloud right from your browser over internet. All you need to have is you need to have an Azure account. That's it. Okay, now these are platforms in which you can create anything over internet. That's why they're also called as cloud platforms. Microsoft Azure is a cloud platform. Is providing this platform provided by a company called Microsoft. So Microsoft is a cloud provider. They provide us cloud platforms. The cloud platform name is Microsoft Azure. Okay. So now, obviously, they provide us services. So they will charge us. The charge is very similar to how we pay for our water bill or electricity bill at home. This model is called as pay as you go, as you use. Okay. For example, mobile recharge for prepaid is different, right? Whether you use it or not, you have to pay for, I think, 300 rupees or 500 rupees per month, or depending on the plans. But water bill or electricity bill, it depends on how much you use, how much you consume. Based on that only will be charged, right? So cloud is also very similar on these charges, on pricing. Okay, so there are many services in Azure. Everything in Azure is a service. For example, you want to create a database, so you create a service. You want to create a server, you create a service. Okay, everything is service. So in cloud, in Azure, there are hundreds of services, but everything will fall under one of these categories. The first category is IaaS. I means infrastructure. Second category is PaaS, platform as a service. And third category is software as a service. All these are categories in cloud. Initially, we had only on-prem. When initially Microsoft guys had only IaaS, then they introduced PaaS, and then they introduced serverless, and SaaS is also there. This course is specifically designed for developers. So developers are always focused on PaaS and serverless. We'll not discuss anything on IaaS. Okay. Our focus will be more on PaaS because IaaS is more for administrators. Okay. Today I'm going to create two PaaS services. Just 15 minutes. Okay. So let's understand what is IaaS and PaaS and SaaS more in the next slide. But for this slide, remember, any service in Azure will have to fall under one of these categories. Let's move on. Now here you see four boxes, vertical box, vertical sections, not boxes, vertical sections. So the first one is on-prem. So each vertical box contains two colors, right? One is in blue, one is in gray. Every box is a responsibility. If it is in blue color, that means it's our responsibility. All these are our responsibility. If it is in gray color, then these are all Microsoft Azure's responsibility. Okay. Now, in on-prem, if your customer is still using on-prem, then we have to take care of all this. When I say we, not developers, but someone in our team. So we could be worrying about networking, storage, everything. We have to purchase servers, virtualize them, install OS, maintain patches after the server is created, and then we have responsible for installation of web servers, frameworks, .NET frameworks, Java frameworks, development of applications and database. It's all our responsibility in on-prem. But when you move to cloud, some of the responsibilities are taken care of by Microsoft guys. So what does it mean when they manage? What is the benefit that we get? So networking is done by them. Servers purchase, storage purchase is done by them. If there is any fault with those physical infrastructure, they will be replaced by healthier ones. It's all Microsoft responsibility. But we are responsible for only from here, right? From purchasing the OS license, installation of OS, of any software, and development and deployment of database applications. So move further, still get more benefits. Everything 80% is done by Microsoft Azure. We are responsible only for development of databases and applications only. This is becoming very popular. Everybody is moving towards PaaS services. Because of the pandemic. Okay. So administrators are more focused on IaaS and developers should be focusing on PaaS. I assume you're all from development background. Okay. And SaaS products, here we don't have anything to do. The vendor who is selling this software will be responsible for doing everything. Do you guys know any SaaS product? Chaitanya and Uday and Chandrasekhar. I'm sure everyone of us use them. But I've used already. You are aware of any such thing? Google Photos, Google Drive, OneDrive, they're all SaaS products. They're all applications that we have not developed. Somebody else has developed them. We can consume them. Of course, we might have to pay money. Yeah, those are all SaaS products. Right, let's work on creating two PaaS services. Okay. So in Azure, PaaS. Web servers. Yes, please go ahead.
Yeah, just wait it. Yeah, PaaS service, like the admin is going to give the access, like is going to create a PaaS or the developer itself.
So usually administrators will be creating PaaS services.
Okay.
But you guys understand all those administrative tasks as well.
Okay.
Okay,
So it could
because
be any type of platform, right? Java or .NET or anything.
Absolutely, yes. I'm going to do that for all those. Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
So in real time, the question is, Chetan is asking, is a developer is responsible for creating this? No. Still, administrators will be creating them. But you guys need to know how they create, because while developing, you will have to focus on some of those aspects as well. Okay. So in general, developers should know more than what an administrator knows about passwords. Okay. So that's why it's important for you to know how to create them, because even in interviews, people ask you guys whether you know how to create them or not. You won't be able to, will not be working on creating them, but very important that you know how to create them, what parameters pass, all that stuff. Okay. All right.
So one more question here. So you said that we need to create an Azure account, right, to get the access to the Azure and all.
Correct. Obviously. Yes.
So after creating an account, so we will be categorized into the admin or the developer, or everybody has the right to create the pass.
Yeah. If you are creating a free account, you will be the administrator, anything. But in your projects, right, there will be a lot of restrictions for developers. Cannot do everything. You'll be restricted.
Okay, who is going to give the access for the developers?
Your administrator.
Okay.
Your team.
Okay.
Who is managing Azure, they will provide you access. You need to request them.
Okay.
All right. We are going to create two services. Our goal is to deploy a .NET based application into Azure PaaS. That's our goal. In order to achieve that, we need to create two services. The first one is a server. In Azure PaaS, the server is called as App Service Plan. In this App Service Plan, you can create one or more app services. I'm going to create one app service in an App Service Plan. So as Chandana was clearly mentioned, very first step is you need to create Azure account. When you join a team, definitely you will have an account, but if you want to practice now, you can create a free account which is valid only for 1 month. Okay? But Microsoft says it's valid for 12 months, you cannot do much for the rest of the 11 months because you can work only with three services. You can do very minimum things, but otherwise create an account. Microsoft gives us $200 credit. You can create within those $200 limit, and they will get expired in 1 month or 30 days. Now while creating an account, it will ask you for a phone number, an email address, and a debit card or credit card. Mostly credit card. With credit card, you should not face any problems, but debit card, many people face problems. So you have to chat. At the bottom, you see a chat with sales, right? So you should be in touch with these guys if you have any problems, okay, with debit card. But credit card, you should not be a problem. So once you create an account, you will be taken to this URL, portal.azure.com. I already have a subscription created and I have services created already. Okay. So the second step is, after you create an account, is we need to create a resource. I already have 5 resources, but for us, I am going to create a new resource. Click on add button. It will open up a new blade. I already have a subscription. When you create a free account, you will also get a subscription like this. I'm going to create a new resource group for us. Let's assume Azure-dev is our project name. Our customer is located in East West. I would like to create a dev environment, and this service name is resource. Service type is resource. So this is a best practice that everybody should follow without fail, because you end up seeing hundreds of services. So how do you know whether a particular service belongs to dev environment, and what is the type of that service, whether it is your primary region or secondary region? All that information must be available in the name itself. That's it. We are done. We have, our resource group is created now. Of course, it is empty. There are no resources. I am going to create two PaaS services now. Okay. So, what is a server? What is a service in Azure, which is equivalent to a server? You guys remember, I showed you that in the PPT. App service plan. Okay, I have to create an app service plan now. Let's go and create one. So click on this and click on create. I hover on this and click on create button. And for every service, you will choose subscription and resource group. That's mandatory. These are our resource group that we have created for dev. Okay. And this is server, right? We need to provide a name. Again, we have to follow the proper naming conventions. Azure Dev is our project name in East West for dev environment. And this is app service plan. You might end up creating multiple app service plans. So provide a name, meaningful name. I mentioned ASP1. But you can provide whatever name you want based on the project. In this server, it is asking us, do you want Linux or Windows? I would like to have Windows. I can choose Linux as well. There's no difference. The only difference is license. Windows is expensive than Linux. First, Windows has license cost additional. Now our customer is based out of US. Who's East US? That's it. And this is the capacity of our server. Right now, I will pick a minimum version, free version, so that I am not charged. I will explain more about this later. But yeah, free server is what we are picking. You're done. Now, click on this button, review plus create. You can review all the details. Here, I am from India, Hyderabad. My customer is from East West for a project. I would like to create a server for them in the East West, right? How much time do you think it would take if I click on create now? Can someone make a guess? We are creating a server. We are creating a, we're installing Windows operating system. Yeah, that's it. So how much time do you think it should take?
Just 2 seconds on the button.
Sorry?
Just maybe 2 seconds left clicking on the button.
Right. In general, it should take a lot of time, right? But it hardly takes 10 seconds or 15 seconds. So our server will be up and running. We can use this for prod environment as well. It's almost production ready. Of course, there are some settings that should be done. Not yet completely production ready, but almost. If you have to do the same thing in on-prem, it takes months together to set up this environment. We have created a server, web server. Of course, it is free. Right? So that's why it is not production. But if you want to increase the capacity, it's very simple. Go to scale up. Review all these settings. How much do you want? 1.75 GB RAM, 8 GB RAM, 16 GB, 32 GB. for production, whatever capacity you want, just pick that and click on apply. That's it. You can do whatever you want. And there is no downtime at all. Hardly took 5 seconds. If I go back to overview, it's showing S1. Earlier it was free. Now it says S1-1. One server. What if you want to enable load balancing with 2 servers or 10 servers? It's very simple. Again, go to scale out and increase this to whatever you want, up to 10. Just put 2, click on save. That's it. Now we have a load balancing environment as well. Go to overview blade, see 2 servers. That's the power of PaaS. There is an inbuilt load balancer. Right? There are 2 web servers attached to a load balancer. We don't need to worry about creation of load balancer, attaching the servers. All that is not required. It's all automatic in PaaS. That's the power of PaaS. Right? Now we are done with creation of our server. Our server is now in a load balancing environment. Now I would like to create a web app. Apps are done in app services. Click on create. Again, you have to select a subscription and a resource group. Okay. Now, what is the name of our web app? Mention. Now, what type of application you are going to deploy? It could be anything. .NET, Java, right? Chetan, you were asking about this. Node.js, anything, or on major platforms. So I have a .NET application. I will choose this. Now, it should be deployed in Windows, East US region. That's our customer's place. And this is our app service plan that we have created. We are good with this. And click on next. I don't worry about automated deployment now. I'm not interested in that now. I would like to monitor our application. Yes. For that, it creates another service called App Insights. Okay. I'm okay with that. Do a final review. All the names, everything, configurations. Click on create. That's it. Another 10 seconds or 20 seconds. Our web application is also up and running. That's the power of PaaS. Overall, the entire environment is set up in 2 minutes or 5 minutes. So it's in progress. I can even browse it. URL is also given to us for this web app. Now I am sharing this with you guys. Okay. So I request you guys to access this. Okay. But you might not even access this. I would like to know whether you are accessing this application or not. So how can I do that? It's very simple. Remember, while creating this, there was monitoring section. Monitoring is enabled with the help of Application Insights. So navigate to Application Insights, go to Live Metrics. Now I understand whether you guys are accessing or not in just 5 seconds. Yeah, nobody is accessing. Yeah, none of you guys are accessing this.
No, getting I this can connect, I can able to connect now. I'm connecting.
Yeah, try. Can you access that? If you access it, I will get a request here. Or let me refresh. See, I made a refresh. So now you guys, some of you have made a request. And now nobody is accessing this, right? So all these are many such features in PaaS. Getting all this. Lot of work. Okay, now we have two servers, right? Those two servers are these. Now our requests are served by which server? We don't know. So I filter this. Can you guys refresh again? I am also refreshing. I refreshed multiple times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10 times. See, almost 7 times. This server is taking that load. I click on this. It has taken only one request. You can also filter based on servers. That is possible. Okay, so you get, there are many such advantages. Did we write any code? No, nothing, right? So in real time, if you want to understand whether you want 2 servers or 10 servers, how do you know that? By looking at this, if there are so many requests coming on to our servers, then based on that, we will understand whether you want 1 server, 2 servers, or 5 servers, or 10 servers. All these tools are built for us. You can also see how much time it took, right? So there are many such nice charts are given to us. Of course, it will take time for them. It takes, I think, 2 minutes, 5 minutes to reflect the data here. Only live metrics shows us live data, but rest of the charts everywhere, they have 2 minutes. Not 2 seconds, but 2 minutes. Okay, all right. So now I'll go back to our web app that we have just created. Sometimes, yeah, this is ours, right? This one, right? No, what is them? Yeah, this one. But we did it just now. Our application is running in 2 servers. So now, if I browse it, it is a very simple plain text. Okay. So far, I have explained all advantages. One disadvantage is you cannot log into that server or those servers. It's not possible in PaaS. Now, if it is not possible, then how will I see what code is deployed? How would I change this? Right? That facility is available. Navigate to App Service and scroll down. There is something called as App Service Editor. On the menu browser tab, and it shows us all the deployed files. Right now we have only one simple static HTML page. Is this so? I would say Azure Developers automatically will be saved. And if I refresh, okay, that's how it works. Now I have a local application in .NET, developed in .NET. I would like to deploy this. So click on start, select Azure. Ours is App Service Windows. Select this, click next. I am already logged in with my account. Choose our app service and then click finish. Now link a local application with app service in Azure. And finally click on publish. This will do 2 things. One, it creates a package and then deploys the package into app service. and then it also opens up a browser and takes us to that page. My default browser is IE, but we are using Chrome. It opens up IE. See, it has opened up IE. But I would like to go here to Chrome and refresh. Of course, it is DevOps, but it can change this text. Okay, let's change that text to development. And we publish again. Before I publish, let me show you the output earlier. See, lots and lots of files were added earlier, right? Adding file, three files, many directories. So now we made only one small change here, and we are publishing here. Before publishing, let me clear this. It's all cleared now, right? So again, I will right click, publish, and click on publish. This time, let's see how many files will be published. See, only two files, very few files are getting published. Only these two. Okay. Publish has started. There is some problem. Okay, it is locked, right? I have opened this, probably that's the reason. I've closed it. Let me do it again. Publish. Yep, it's done. It was very quick this time. And opened up a browser as well. And our change is reflected. A lot of development integration is inbuilt with Azure. I'm not sure if you guys are a .NET developers, Chaitanya and Uday, but I can even do a remote debugging as well. Right from my local machine, I can debug this live application running in Azure. That is also possible. Okay. All right. So we did not create any server, not log into server, we did not install OS, right? Just created two services in Azure. All that will take care. Now, I don't want to spend money on two servers, so I would like to remove one server. It's very simple. See, we did not deploy into two servers. There are two servers, but we just did one deployment. When if you have 10 servers, you have to do only one deployment. So automatically, every server will have access to those files, to our code. That's how PaaS is developed. If it is on-prem, you have a load balancing environment with three servers, four servers. You will have to deploy your code into all those four servers or 10 servers, whatever it is. There's a chance that you might miss one server. Anything could happen. Right? While deploying, you have to remove that server from load balancing. You have to deploy everything and then attach to that load balancing again. So I have seen many people doing all that manual jobs in on-prem. But this, as everything is there, you don't have to worry about anything. Just deploy once, every server in the load balancing environment will take that latest code and start showing that to end users. Okay, so let me remove one and make it one. Click on save. That's it. While I'm doing this, there is no downtime. You see, our site is still up. Don't see downtime at all. Technically, there will be a slight downtime, but as a human, you will not. That's the power of PaaS. Okay. So in this course, we are going to learn 15 search services. There are hundreds of services. So we will not be, I don't know all those services. Even if I know, it's impossible to cover everything, right? So we will be covering 15 different services. Today we have just created two services, right? We'll go in depth on this. We'll do hands-on, similar hands-ons on this, and all these we'll look at all these services. There are around 15 services. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 15. So this is a weekend batch. We are starting the new batch from Saturday onwards, the upcoming Saturday, 7 to 9, and Sunday 7 to 9. So, or at least we'll spend 5 hours during the weekend, 2.5 hours, 2.5 hours per day. Overall duration, overall we'll spend around 25 hours. So we'll do around 5 weeks. Okay. So we'll be focusing more on real time. I am into Azure since six years. And I am also an author of a book. Right. So whatever challenges that I have faced, I will be sharing all those with you guys. Any questions?
Can you share your course content, because what are the topics we'll cover?
You can be in touch with Malati. Malati has the course content. I don't have your contact details, so I will not be able to do that. So Malati will be doing that. Malati will share you the course content and the link as well. So in case if you are interested, you can join from Saturday.
Yes, thank you.
Final questions, guys. If not, we'll stop it here for today. And
hi Praveen.
Mm-hmm, yeah,
I'm Shalem here. I would just like to know, in this particular course, this is Azure development, I believe. Yes. In this course, would you give us some knowledge about Dockers and AKS?
Docker and AKS, we will try, smart part, but in case if you're interested, I will show you. I can show you how to Docker an application, how to deploy that in AKS. Yes.
Okay, that would be great, Praveen.
Sure.
So when we did start? Saturday.
Yeah, Saturday.
Okay then. Please do let me know. I would like to join this course.
Sure. Even this recording can be recorded now. Request Malati to share this recording, you can go through that recording.
Okay, then fine.
If you don't have time, you can join Saturday and then you can let us know if you're interested Saturday after the lecture. That's also fine. Okay.
So okay, you mean to say Saturday you have one more demo or what?
No, it's not demo, it's actual sessions will start.
Okay, then fine.
So at what time on Saturday, sir?
7 a.m.
Okay. And one more question, like the Azure developer is required to know about the Azure admin also?
A little bit of administration, yes. I will be teaching that in this course.
Okay. So this will be, admin also will be covered.
Okay. Yes, yes. Administration is also covered along with developer.
Okay.
Okay. All right then. Thank you, guys. Thanks for your time. Bye-bye.